just realized that kind of sounds like we're in the Haunted Mansion or something. A little spookier than I remembered it last week. Good morning, everyone. So what we're doing today is kind of unique. We're modeling what worship was like last night. We thought we'd give you a chance to see what it looks like so you can tell others about it, that we went ahead and set our area up here like we did last night. This is often called a pray ground, is what they call it. And last night we had these tables full and things going on, and one of the things I asked Susie to do at the beginning was to say, and I want all parents to hear this, that there is no shame here. You know, if they're out running around and crazy things are happening, that's the way family together, that's how together worship works, and it actually was a real blessing to be a part of it last night. But I have to tell you, it was the scariest sermon I've preached in a long time. I get nervous about a lot of things, but preaching to 80-year-olds and 2-year-olds is quite the stretch. Wesley's pretty good about it. He takes me in really well. And the same was true this morning. I had no kids up front, except for I finally got Jake Johansson, who came up and sat at the craft table, and Reed Johansson, who sat, of course, in one of the gliders. So if your inner child says, I want to be up there, feel free to come up and play and be a part of it. So what I want to do today is I need to have a lineup. All right? Can all the gentlemen... Well, all the men stand up, even the non-gentlemen. There we go. Everybody stand up. And what I need is, I need the tallest. And I kind of scored that already because I got some tall... We could start a basketball team. Come on down, Jonathan. Is that hers? All right. So, Jonathan, I need you to stand right there. Everybody, men, stay standing. And I need the shortest of us to come up. Okay. Who's that going to be? Kane or Carter? Either one of you want to come up? Carter, do you want to come up? Come on up. All right. I want you to... All right. You come stand right here, Carter. Thank you. And I need some guys in between. So if you're almost as tall, good job. Come stand between. Come on down this way. There you go. And face that way. All right? Come on, Todd. You come on up here. There we go. Let's see. Who else can we grab? Josiah, come on up. Andrew, Anthony, I mean. Come on up. I don't know my own kids apart. They're still. So line up by height. Oop. You go on that side of them. You go on that side. Okay, a couple more. Let me have them. Quint, you're new. I know you're excited about jumping up in front of everyone. Come on, stand up here. Tom, you'd be a great one to join us up here. I think you'll fit into the space as well. So come on in. There you go.
Put us in order, y'all. Come on.
Yeah, that's perfect. Good. They're right there. And one more. Wait to see. Can I get one more up here? Oh, this is good enough. Do we have someone? All right, come on in the back there. Yeah, you've been... You got brought out whether you wanted to or not. I could tell you were dying to get up here. Isn't that... Yes. What I came to church for was to find out if I could get stand in front of everybody and get nervous. Okay, so what I want you to do, whoop, is to think about this. If you were to pick, okay, guys, you can sit down now. You all made it. That grace is sufficient for you, right? That's good. So what I want you to think about, if you were to pick one of these people, and you're going to pick him to be your king, to do your fighting for you, to run your country, which one would you choose? Well, I think it's pretty obvious. Okay, so this is what I'm going to do. Remember, no shame, Josh, no shame. Don't worry, okay? It's cool. It's cool. Carter, we're coming on back here. We're kind of in the middle of an example here. There we go. Okay, so when I raise a hand above them, I want you to cheer if that's the one you want for your king. Ooh, that was a little weak. Come on there. There we go. Cheering section over here, okay? For Josiah. All right, Todd. How about for Quinn? Second time here. Good stuff. And your name is
Jose.
Jose. Oh gosh, Jose is here. For Jose, huh? For Anthony. And I think I know what's going to happen. And for Carter. Carter, they all want to pick you. Okay, you all can have a seat. Whew, we got through that. That was great stuff. Okay, Carter, you won. You won it, man. You're the king. You go tell mom and dad I'm king. But let's leave the music stand here, okay? Our music is going to be a little confusing the rest of the day, but if we sing the same song over again, you know why. Let's hear it for Carter. Yeah, King Carter. He'll never sit still in church again. Isn't that great? So what happened was like this, what we just saw. Jesse was brought his seven sons before Samuel. Samuel was charged by God to pick out the new king. And he said, he's coming from the people of Jesse. And so Jesse paraded the people across. And the scripture talks about the very first son coming back. And he was like the captain of the football team, the king of the homecoming court, and the class president, all built in one. He was great for the job. And Samuel went up and stood before him, and God said, not that one. And he continued to do that. He continued to go down the line till they were smaller and smaller, and going through all seven of them that stood in front of him. And each time he'd stand before him, God said, not that one. And Samuel knew, it's not that one. It's not that one. Not that one. He went to all seven of them, and he turned to Jesse and he said, Jesse, is this all your kids? Is this all your boys? And he said, well, there's the littlest one. And, you know, the littlest one. We have him back home tending the sheep. And Samuel said, well, we're not doing anything till he comes in front of us, because God said one of these boys. And sure enough, he brings David in, and we know what happens. David, God said, that's the one. And that's exactly how it works. It works, and God said, this is the one. Matthew 20:16 said, so the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Children are in the fog. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this setting today to remind us what the family of God is really about. And we pray that you will speak into this, and may our kids and our big kids all hear you today in some way, shape, or form, that they would grow in knowing you better. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So what Brittany just did, this, we did this last week in the first service, and we're doing it again this week. Every time I say the word fog, you got to respond, family of God, because that's what the fog's about. So if I say fog, and Rosanna's going to say fog, family of God. She's still learning over there. That's why we're working with her on that one. Fog! There, we got it. So today we're talking about the fog again. Does anybody know what I mean when I say fog? You all do. That's great. Good job. Last week we had some youth join the church, and we said that those youth were part of the fog. Part of the family. That's right. And who else do you think is part of the family? All of us. That's right. Well, today, what I love about our story today is that it was the youngest son. It was the littlest one who was made king. Big things come in small packages. And today is all about children who are in the fog. Very good. You guys are good at this. So why was David chosen? Why do you think David was chosen? Anybody? He had a heart for God. Were you in the first service, or you just knew that? Both. Okay. David was chosen because he had a heart for God. Psalm 63, which we believe David penned, says this. You, God, are my God. I earnestly seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. He was the one who loved God, and he loved God enough to work for God. Today we have big people and we have little people, like Mr. Carter over there. We have the big ones and the little ones. And guess which one God wants more? He wants all of us. Amen? And that's exactly what God wants. But God wants us not because of how big our bodies are, like wherever Jonathan is again. He's probably hiding by now. Or small like Carter is right now. But he wants us because of what's in here. what's in our hearts. That's what God, and he knew that's what David had. David loved God and God knew his heart. Even though he was the youngest in the whole family, he's the one they chose. So does this mean young people count? Yes, you bet it does. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew 19, verse 14. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Today is about children. And this service that we started last night, in a way, is about fixing what the church has sometimes done wrong. You see, when we worship together, we learn together. When we worship together, we learn together, right? Amen. Nods? Good. Everyone agrees? Good. Carter, do you agree? Yep. Just give me a thumbs up. There we go. All right. He agrees too. We are together as a family of God, and we are here to let the little children, the Davids among us, get to know God along with us. That's what this whole service was about that started last night. You see, when I was little, my parents took me to church, and I was put in a Sunday school class just for kids. Anybody else have that? Just for kids. And my parents went someplace else. I guess it was a Sunday school just for parents or just for adults or something. But the point is, I never got to learn about God with my parents. I don't really know what they were like in Sunday school either. Maybe they were the class clown. That seems to be something that I may have gotten from them, in case you didn't notice. But I don't know. I just never got to be with them when they were in these places. And there were times when they told me about Jesus, but it was usually when I did something wrong. Anybody else have that? Jesus does not like that. Do you ever get that? That's the Jesus I learned from my parents a lot of times. But parents have the single most influence on children. Let me say that again. Parents have the single most influence on children. And parents could be the first to share about God. And wouldn't that be amazing if we could start doing that, whether it be in this place or whether it be at home? What is also true about my parents is that my parents never got to learn about God from me. Now, I've listened to my three kids as they sat in their car carriers when they were younger, and they talked about God, each of them, with such confidence. Anthony, where are you? Is it all right if I talk about you? Good, because I did in the first service, too, and I forgot to ask. Sorry. So Anthony, one day, he just said, "I know who God is." And he said, "God is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit." And he said it with such confidence that he knew that it was true. No questions asked. But somewhere along the way, we, and that's us in the comfy chairs, we all wise up, in quotes. We go somewhere in that journey, and our trust in God isn't the same. I'm wherever, and that's just kind of, and I'm afraid what happens is that we've learned that from our parents, that we actually, as parents, kind of build in that, well, that's real sweet, but is that Jesus? But the truth is, kids know God for who God is. No questions asked. And I'd like to think that we can make a difference in people's lives by giving them some ground. When I listen and think about the times my parents talked to me in the car, or if I occasionally acted up in worship, occasionally, weekly, whatever, you know, that didn't sound like the same God that I was taught to know. And so it makes a big difference. And I think that we have built that in, and we've got to be careful of that. So here in this place, we come to be with God together. Anybody lose track of who God is because these guys are up here? No, absolutely not. And that's what we want to see happen. Children teach about Jesus just like anybody else. And the memories of this place, the memories of this day right here with Carter roaming around, can last a lifetime for both of us. It may be the day he remembers he got up in front of church when he was very little. It would be the day I remember he picked up the mic stand and was showing his strength right from the beginning. He was going to win the King Prize, man. That was beautiful. And we won't soon forget that. Now, here's the problem. My memory of when my mom and dad shared their faith story, I don't have that. My parents are both gone now, and I won't ever have that. As a little person, I never had the chance to share my faith story with them either. But here's one thing I've learned, especially here in this church in the last couple of years. If you give children the chance, they will teach us. Amen? Yes. Isaiah 11:6 says this, and you guys, listen to these stories. Listen to these animals. The wolf shall lie down with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the kid. Not one of you, and that means a baby goat. The calf and the lion and the fatling together. And then it says, and a little child shall lead them. Now, how crazy is that to think that a wolf and a lamb are going to lay down together? That this vicious animal is going to make noise and lay down with a lamb that's just quiet and gentle. It's talking about, but what it's really doing is it's talking about a time that there's no more fear or danger or worry. We like to call that peace. And then it says this, and a little child shall lead them. So a child shall lead us to that place. Now, for a lot of people, people believe that Jesus, that is talking about when Jesus came as a baby to lead us all to God. But I believe it is about God's plan for us all. So children are an important part of the family. They're the first shall be last and the last shall be first. Like David, it is the littlest ones that teach us. Now David was picked that day when we heard it in Scripture. And he didn't become king until many years later. But from that day on, he was anointed. He was anointed to be an agent for God, to be that place for God. And that's true for every one of our kids. They are to be God for the world. And that's why they're important to us. The little ones are going to teach us. Even though God picked you, it might not be right now. But remember that God has picked you. That's what's important. Now, for some, God is already using them to lead us. In the last year, we've had several children, like I think we're up to about a half a dozen, that told their parents, I want to be baptized. They hadn't been baptized yet, and they really felt the call to be baptized, and they knew what it was about. They understood what it was about. And that has let them see the truth better than those who have had their minds changed. You see, they see the real thing. And that's why Jesus said this in Matthew 18:3. Truly I tell you, unless you change, and I think it means, by the way, hi Mia, I think it means change back. Unless you change or change back and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of God. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And for the rest of us in the cheap seats, the rest of us, this is really important. And we really need to give children and youth a chance. Because what does it say in verse 6? If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck to be drowned in the depths of the sea. These kids are important. Amen? So I'm going to have a little project here. I need some kids to come up. Can you guys come up? Anybody want to come up? Mia, you want to come up here for a second? Can you come here? I'm going to show you about an apple. You want to learn about it? Or you want to just do your craft? Questions. See, there's an apple right there. So what is this right here? Do you know? That's an apple. That's right. Let's hear it for Mia. She's got that one right. Good. So, but in an apple, there's all sorts of parts to an apple. Did you know that? There's there's the stem, right? That's part of the apple. And let's see, what else is here? There's the core.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.